So without further ado, I'm happy to introduce Alexandru Nica. You tell us about the commonwealth aspects of free property.
Thank you. It is a pleasure to be at this winter school, and I'd like to thank Nati and all the organizers for the opportunity to give these lectures on this direction of research in combinatorics, yeah, okay, or around combinatorics, yeah. And what we study in the combinatorial side of free probability, and in general in free probability, yes, we study the notion of free independence. For elements who live where, so they live now, what's the framework that we use? It's an abstract version of space of functions. So in an abstract version of ring of integrable functions. Yeah, and actually, so this will be the structure. Well, so rings, so some objects that you can add and multiply. In fact, we want them to be also forming a vector space. Yeah, so ring and vector space, these structures together, when you have all the three operations, so addition, multiplication, and multiplication by scalars, you call this an algebra. The field of scalars which we like is the complex numbers. Yeah, okay. And let me tell you that this is meant to be as an introductory course, easily followable, yeah? And it's also going to be peppered by little exercises, which are usually straightforward and are just meant for you to kind of make sure that you are keeping up with the definitions and various facts that are being given, yeah? Okay? And let me advertise that actually there is a so some of these exercises that I'm going to talk about today and a whole bunch of exercises appear in a warm up handout which is posted on the website of the Winter School. Yeah, in fact today I will start by the first part of my lecture will cover some bits of that warm up. Handout, and we will also solve some of those exercises. Yeah, okay. Also, let me mention that despite, like here, this terminology might look a bit like so functions and probability, but this will be a combinatorics sequence of lectures. So really, it's going on the combinatorics of it. What kind of combinatorics it is? So let me write this here from the beginning. So that our workhorse for the various calculations that we do and the facts that we prove are the so-called lattices of non-crossing partitions. NC of N, which will appear today. Let me advertise that there is also a handout on the website of the Winter School about that. So it's the NC basics handout. Yeah. And if I'm to say here in this space what kind of combinatorics they have, this is Catalan combinatorics. NC of N turns out to be one of the very many combinatorial structures which are counted by Catalan numbers. Yes, so in particular, this is the exercise one from the NC handout. If you count them, you get the nth Catalan number. And this sequence of numbers, 1, 2, 5, 14, 42, and so on, this will appear all the time in the present lectures. Okay? Now let me tell you a bit about the plan. So the plan that I would have for this sequence of lectures. So, plan. So in the lecture one today, I'd like to actually give you the basics of free independence, yeah, and tell you actually. So we will see the basic definitions, okay. But then we will see the most important tool for the combinatorial aspects of this theory, which are the free cumulants. So this is what I want to arrive to introduce today, and also tell you the main result about them, okay. Then lecture two will be about the R transform, okay? And this is a transform which plays in free probability a role somehow analogous. So if you are familiar with the concept of characteristic function of a probability distribution in usual probability, the R transform is in some sense the analog of that. Yeah, I repeat, of course, that we will have it all in the language of combinatorics. So it's not going to be like we don't do analytic aspects here. Yeah. There is an interesting theory of what happens when you have these free elements when you multiply them. And I will explain how that goes. Yeah. There is another transform which is used in connection to that called the S transform. Okay. And now, okay, so it may happen that these lectures 1, 2, 3 actually take all my 4 slots. So then there would be nothing after that. But if there is to be something like a dessert for this sequence of lectures, I'd like to speak an amusing topic, how this R transform connects to some objects called meanders. Yeah. So this is for amusement. Connection to meanders. Now, this is actually a serious problem. These are some objects that you can draw very nicely, but for which, it is an open problem to determine the growth rate of how these objects grow. Yes, when n goes to infinity. What I like to show, if time is there is a certain result of Landau and Zvonkin. Which gives an upper bound for the growth constant of meanders. And since it's coming like this with R transforms, I can show how what they do there is actually comes to computing the radius of convergence of a certain R transform. But anyway, so this was the plan. Yeah. Okay. So then, this being the plan, I'll then go and start the lecture one. Yeah. For the next bit, I will follow the warm-up handout. Yeah. So start with the framework that we want to use. Yeah. So lecture one is free independence and free cumulants. Okay? And item one here, yes, is the framework that we want to use. Yeah, and this is called star probability space. Yeah. Okay. And so here's the definition. So a star probability space is a pair. So an A and a phi. So what is A? So A, as I said, it's that ring and at the same time vector space. Yeah. So A is an algebra over the complex numbers. We ask it to be a unit, unital. So the ring has a unit, which I'll call 1A. Okay, and actually, I think it's nice for the kind of how the things flow to also carry on this star. So this is like a complex conjugation. So it's a star operation. Yeah. So it is also endowed with a star operation. Every element has an adjoint, yeah? And this has the usual properties like the star operation, like the conjugate transpose from complex matrices, yeah? So this is antilinear. The star of the product is the product of the stars, but in reversed order, yeah? And also, it has the property that if you take it twice, you get back your element that you started with. Yeah. Okay. So this is A. Yeah. And examples for A, we will see. Like certainly one example could be A could be the algebra of d by d matrices over the complex field. Yeah. But also A could be the algebra of polynomials where this is just the conjugation. Yeah. Okay. What about phi? Space. What about phi? Phi is a linear map. We normalize it by saying that the unit must go to one, yeah, and then there is a positivity condition. So phi of A star A is greater or equal to zero always, yeah. So elements of the form A star A is what you could think of as like the positive elements of your algebra, yeah, and phi must send them to real non-negative numbers. Yeah, and moreover, we ask some strict positivity. So this inequality can be an equality if and only if A is the zero element of the algebra. Yeah, so phi is strictly positive definite. Yeah, okay. And the way to think about this is like so. This is a ring and a vector space. This algebra is some like an abstraction of a space of functions. Which are integrable, and then taking phi of A is like taking an integral. So here is like an integral sign. Here you say that the integral of the unit is 1, and the integral of something non-negative must be a non-negative number. Yeah, that's the framework. Okay, and as I said, once I throw a definition, yeah. After that, it's nice to do a little exercise to stabilize the concept in the mind, yeah. So let's do an exercise. Here, this as it happens is the exercise one. Yeah, question.
Is tau of the unit element is the unit element? Is tau of the unit element is the unit element?
The star. Yeah. But this actually can be proved. Yes, because the unit is unique, and you prove that the adjoint of the unit is also a unit, so therefore they must coincide. Yeah, but that's true always. Yeah. Okay. So exercise one from the handout. Yeah. I propose to be like in a course that we do the exercises 1, 3, 5. Yes. So that the odd numbered exercise we do and the even number exercise, those are the true homework. Yeah. That. Okay. So let's prove. Well, already that was a little proof there. Let's prove that we also, so the general behavior under star operation, phi pulls out the conjugate. Yeah, okay, so what's the solution? Yeah, so for this one I'm going to write the solution without trying to get the people from the audience to do it for me. Yeah? So hi, what's the solution? So suffices to check. I say. So first observation. whenever you have a self-adjoint element. Phi of A is real. Yeah? And why does that suffice? Why it suffices? And here I say, please fill in the details. Yeah, so how do you go from this one to that one? The fact is that an arbitrary element in A, you can decompose it in a real and imaginary part. Every a in the algebra, you can write it as x plus I y, where x and y are self-adjoint, and if you know this for x and y, you get that. Okay, so suffices to check that phi of a self-adjoint is a real number. Okay, and then what do we know? We know that phi of a positive is a real non-negative number, so then it's enough if we can write any self-adjoint as a difference of two positive elements. Yeah. So next observation is that. That every A can be written as B star B minus C star C for some B C in A, yeah? Because then phi of A will appear as phi of B star B minus phi of C star C and will be a difference of two real non-negative numbers, so it's going to be real, yeah, okay? So then, how do we find such BC? Yeah, so then it's boiled down to this. So, it's disappointingly simple how we find BC, but of course there can't be too complicated because it's too general, right? I mean, what do we know in this algebra A? Besides the element A, we know nothing except that there is a unit. Yeah. So then we use some stupid binomial identity. Yeah. And for instance, we can take B and C can be both self-adjoint. So this will become difference of squares. Yeah. And you can just take these two fellows, yeah, and done, yeah, end of solution. Like you can of course yes square, do the algebra and see that A comes back, yeah. So yeah, stupid little exercise, but the point is that now I hope you are kind of in more in friendly terms with this kind of structure, and we are ready to move on, yeah. I have here so. So let me mention a point. So there are some main examples that people look at. Well, there are many examples that people look at, but here are like the most important ones. Yes, as I mentioned. So one is you can take an algebra of functions. Say you take the polynomials for simplicity, and then say you take phi to be the integral of the polynomial from say 0 to 1. Yeah? So here it's a case when the star probability space really looks like a probability space in some sense, like it's a these are real functions and taking phi really is an integral. Yeah? But as I also pointed out, you can take A to be an algebra of matrices, yes, and then phi, the linear function phi, you take it to be you take the trace, but then because of that condition that the unit must go to one, you must normalize the trace. Yeah, okay, and I should point out that from these two examples we borrow terminology. Yeah, so we have like various terms that we use for star probability spaces come either from example A or from example B. For instance, from example A, yes, we take the word expectation. So we take draw terminology from examples. This is what I'm saying. And from the example A, the value phi of A goes under the name of expectation of A. And you can also talk about the variance. So this quantity is called the variance. Yeah, and then in general, you talk about moments. Yeah, so phi of A to the n is called moment of order n. Of A, yeah. So the sequence of phi of A to the n is called the moment sequence of your A. Yeah. On the other hand, from B you take terms like say when A is equal to A star, you say that it is self-adjoint. E.g. call A. So as you're saying, self-adjoint if A is equal to A star. You call A unitary when U star and U star U are the unit. You call it a projection when it is an idempotent. This U is A. Yeah. So well, call A unitary when A star and A star A are one. Yeah, projection means that A is equal to A square equals A star, so self-adjoint and idempotent. Yeah, okay, and various all names, various names from linear algebra. Yes, you can use them here in connection to our star operation. Okay, let me mention another example. Yeah, because it's polynomials. It's a very special. So take the integral of a polynomial. This is really a very simple-minded example. If all phi, no. This is positive linear functionals on polynomials. These are in general. Here you go, you have to integrate against a positive measure on the interval 0, 1.
But it's always a measure, right?
I don't know because now if I had put here all continuous functions on 0, 1, I just threw in that example. So of course, like you can put here integration against a density or against some measure on 0, 1, and I think it's true that if you have a positive functional on continuous functions, then it's always given by a measure. I don't know if you just give it on polynomials. I don't know if you can extend. Yeah.
But it's not of theorem concerning the functional on the Hausdorff, on the local compact Hausdorff space.
Yeah, absolutely, yes. But yeah, sure. So, as I said, I'm not prepared to go into the analytic aspects of it. Okay, good. What I was going to say is there is a third example also, like I give it here in a simple-minded form. So say that G is a group. Maybe I can do this. I can move this here, and then I can put the example C next to A and B. Yeah. So the example of the group algebra, which I mentioned because that's where, like, when you talk about free independence, that's where the name free came from. So from this line of examples. So say that G is a group. Okay. And take A to be the group algebra. So what's this? You take a vector space which has a basis indexed by G. Yeah, some elements which you denote as UGs. Yeah. So they are linearly independent and they span this. And then to make this into an algebra, you postulate how they multiply. They multiply by following the multiplication of the group. Yeah. To make this to also introduce a star operation, you postulate it on the UGs. Yeah. Okay. So for every GH in the group, okay, and what's the linear functional? So again, you define it on the basis. So phi of UG equals 1, if G is the unit of the group, and is 0 otherwise. Yeah. And this is called the canonical trace of the group algebra. The reason is that it's having, it turns out to have this property that trace has, namely that phi of xy is equal to phi of yx. So even though A is not commutative, when you apply phi, you can switch x and y under phi. Yeah. Okay. So for this reason, goes under canonical trace. But anyway, so indeed, this is a little exercise which appears as exercise in the handout. I think this is exercise 2, which we don't do. Yeah, that this phi indeed satisfies the properties. Say phi of A star A, why is it always greater equal 0, and why is it equal 0 precisely when A is the 0 element? Yeah. Okay. So easy to check. Yeah. So if you have the moment to do that, please do. Yeah. Okay. So anyway, so we have this framework, yes, looked at it, did a bit of playing with it, and saw some example. Now time to move on. Yeah. So point 2, this concept of free independence. Free independence in a star probability space. Yeah. And this will look a bit stuffy, but in order to kind of sweeten a bit the pill, let's discuss first the concept of classical independence. Let's see what that would be. So for motivation, see first classical independence. And let me tell you how I discuss about independence in this framework. Yeah. So take a star probability space. And inside there, I'm taking two subalgebras which I want to be independent from each other, B and C. Yeah. But for classical, in classical things commute. So I'll take B and C. So B and C, let them be unital star subalgebras. Yes, meaning that they are closed under all the operations and also they contain the unit of A. Yeah, and for classical, we ask them to commute. Yeah, which means that when you multiply an element from B with an element from C, you can do it in any order. Okay, and then what I observe is that, okay, so if you look at what B and C generate together, so take the star algebra generated by B and C together, because of the commutation, this is simply the span of the products B times C. Yeah. So then the star algebra okay, this is the span of products B times C with B in B and C in C. Yeah, that's immediate why, because this, the elements of this form, they are closed under multiplication and under star operation. Yes, if you do B1, C1, B2, C2, this is B1, B2, C1, C2, and also B, C star, this would give you C star, B star, but it's also B star, C star. Yeah. Okay. B and C, we call them classically independent. Classically independent. When this happens, so let me write it here. Yes, the functional phi factors on those products BC. That's linear independence. So when factor holds, yeah, and factor is this requirement that phi of BC equals phi of B times phi of C for every B in B and C in C. Yeah, okay. And indeed, like if you are familiar with independence from probability or measure theory, actually you can see how this relates. Like there you talk about a probability space and about sigma algebras, and you take about the independence for two sub sigma algebras. This is something that you can forget. It's so this is a bit of an aside. Yeah, and if instead of looking at the sub sigma algebras, you look at the functions which are measurable with respect to those sub-sigma algebras, then in your classical measure theory course, you come exactly with something like this, where B and C are functions which are integrable and are also measurable with respect to a certain sub-sigma algebra. Yeah, okay, so end of parenthesis. But anyway, so combinatorially, yes, we have just this situation, yeah, so two star subalgebras, they commute. If this happens, we declare them to be independent. That's that.
Is this just the expectation of the product? Is the product
yes,
the
yes, exactly. Case? Yes, exactly. Okay. one interpretation here, yeah? Okay, this is what I should have said. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. What I want to actually point out is what's the interpretation that I want to give to this situation is that, so see, if you know how phi acts on guys from B and on guys from C, then you can determine phi on this whole star subalgebra. Yeah. So in this case, if we know phi restricted to B and phi restricted to C, then we can calculate phi restricted to the star algebra generated by B and C together. Yeah, it's so simple that is not even worth mentioning normally. But I mention it to make a point that what I want to do is exactly this in a context where what happens if I drop the commutation. Yeah. So we have this. Yes, we have the factorization, which is classical independence. It has this trivial interpretation. Okay. And now what I do next is to ask what happens if we don't assume that B and C commute. Yeah. If we don't assume that B and C commute, then that simple formula for the star algebra which they generate no longer holds. Yeah. So what if we drop the assumption that B and C commute? Yeah, okay. So then the star algebra which is generated by B union C still is a span, but now I must do so can't stop to 1 BC. I must do longer products, B1, C1, B2, C2, BN, CN, yes, where N is greater or equal 1, the B's are in B, the C's are in C. Yeah? Okay? So what I want is the situation. So again, supposing that I have the phi, which acts on the whole space A, yeah? What I want is some stronger condition, which still allows me that from knowing the restrictions of phi to B and to C, to compute the values of phi on now all these longer products. Yeah? Free independence will be exactly like that. So to kind of come to the point, free independence is a recipe which will tell you how to calculate phi of something like this in terms of the restrictions of phi to B's and to C's. And of course, if you know that B and C are freely independent, yeah, okay. So now I can give the formal definition, yeah, and so let me write here the warning. Yes, so free independence is a recipe which allows us to calculate, to compute phi on this bigger algebra, yes, in a special situation. Okay. And so then now I can write the definition. Yeah. So when do I say that B and C are freely independent? I think actually notationally it's easier instead of B and C to call them A1 and A2. Yeah. And then I can actually do any finite number of subalgebra. So I'll do it like that. So let A phi be a star probability space. Yeah? Okay. And you have some unital subalgebras. So instead of B and C, I'm just going to say so unital star subalgebras A1, A2, AK. Yeah? Are said to be free or freely independent when they satisfy a condition. I'm going to write it on the next panel. Let's call it FR IND. Yeah, okay, so the free independence condition. And the free independence condition goes like this. So suppose you pick yourself. So it's got to be something with an n. Yeah. So you pick yourself an n, and you pick yourself some indices out of 1, 2, 3, k. Yeah. So you pick some indices i1, in from 1, 2, 3, k. Yeah. And actually, for this independence, it's important that consecutive indices are not equal to each other. For this definition, yeah, so you want this kind of condition, okay? And now that you have these indices between 1 and k, you start picking elements. So you pick an element a1 from the algebra ai1, and so on, AN from AIN. Yeah, so you pick elements from the subalgebras with these indices. Yeah, and what you want to pick elements that are so-called centered. Yeah, you say that an element is centered when phi of A, phi of that element is zero. Yeah, so when you have this kind of situation, yeah, then you want phi of A1 AN, so phi of the product, also to be zero. Yeah, that's the condition. Yeah, so it looks a bit stuffy. Yeah, but as I'm saying, so it is in fact, so it is a more evolved, yes, version of the just that factorization condition that we had in the classical case. Yeah, looks like that. Where is the motivation for this, and why is it called free? The motivation comes from the example of the group algebras. Yeah, and this is exercise 4 in the warm-up handout. Yeah, so you see there like there is the natural concept of free subset in a group, where you just say that there are no relations between the elements of the set. If you go from the group to the group algebra and you look at the subalgebras generated by those elements, you come to something like this. Yeah, okay. So that's the animal to be examined, yeah, and doesn't look so appealing, yeah. In fact, this is one of my main points, that in order to do calculations in free probability, you don't do them by definitions. You must start with the definition, but actually the method which is much more efficient is the one of free cumulants, the one that I'm going towards, yeah. But anyway, so this is how they were introduced. This is how the concept was introduced. This was by Voiculescu in early 1980s, yeah? And Voiculescu told me personally that he did this. He was just looking at the group algebras of the free groups and came up with this without having further examples, yet turned out to be a very juicy structure, yeah? Okay, let's do an exercise. To get familiar with this, yes, I believe this is an exercise. This is the exercise 3 in the handout. Yeah. And let's do some. Actually, what I want to do is do some calculations for small n to see what happens. So you see, like there is this condition. If you have this product, yeah, and made in a certain way, you know that if the letters of this word are centered, then the product itself has to be the word itself has to be centered, yeah. Let's get back to the BNC language for this special exercise, yeah. Okay. Let's check that this definition contains the factorization. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And let's do let's at least see in principle how we would do. So part B of the exercise. What happens if we want to calculate? So you see, like if you have two subalgebras B and C, yes, then what you want to calculate is phi on various products like this: BC, B1, C1, B2, C2, then product of lengths 6, B1 with 3 Bs and 3 Cs and so on. Yeah. So here is just the factorization. Here, you get something. Actually, this is the longest formula which I can remember, and I will explain at some point why I can remember it. So you go like this. So you split the C's, but you keep the B's together. Plus, there is a term where you split the B's and you keep the C's together. And minus this kind of product, where all the B's and the C's are separated. Yeah. Okay. So this is like for illustration. To see like this is the kind of formulas that you get. So you see difference between this definition and this case is that here it is no longer assumed that phi of B1 and phi of C1 and so on are equal to zero. If phi of each of these guys would be zero, then the general formula would say that phi of the product is zero too. But if they are general sum numbers, then instead of zero, you get some polynomial in phi's at b's and at c's, which happens to look like this. Yeah, you see here this one point that this is exactly what I was saying, that phi of a general product of b's and c's is calculated in terms of the restrictions of phi only to b's or only to c's. You see, so b's separated from c's, b's separated from c's, and same here. Yeah. Okay, and the solution. So the way to do calculations from the definition, there's a method called centering. It's quite straightforward. Yes. So centering means that you take the element and whatever its expectation was, you subtract it. Yeah. So here, for part A of the exercise, part A is exactly what I erased. Okay. So part A, let's write it here again. Yeah. So. Let's give some names to phi of B and phi of C. Yes, and then it is for some reason customary to put a bubble. So B bubble is B minus beta times the unit. C bubble is C minus gamma times the unit. Yes, this is the procedure called centering. Yes, so then phi of B bubble and phi of C bubble are both equal to zero. Yeah. Okay. And then the condition of free independence. Yeah. Free independence gives that phi of B bubble C bubble is zero. Yes. This is exactly one of those products. So lengths two, elements from different subalgebras, and which are centered. Yeah. Okay. So hence, 0 equals phi of B bubble C bubble, so it's B minus beta times C minus gamma. Yeah, and now we just expand. So this is BC minus beta C minus gamma B plus beta gamma. Yeah, and you see here that you get exactly, two terms cancel, and you get phi of BC equals beta gamma. Yeah, which is the so the required formula. Yeah. So in the case this was kind of I could do it for lengths two. This goes in any lengths, only that it's becoming more and more cumbersome. Yeah. So for the solution to part B of the exercise. Yeah, we would do exactly the same. We will not do it. Yeah, but so how do we? I think I should. So for the solution to part B. we do exactly in the same way. Yeah. So put now phi of bi equals beta I, phi of ci equals gamma I, and put bi bubble equals bi minus beta I unit, ci bubble is equal ci minus gamma I unit, where I is 1 or 2. Yeah. And what we do is we start from B1 bubble, B2 bubble, C1 bubble, C2 bubble now are center, and the free independent the free independence condition tells us that this is zero. Yeah, this is zero, and what we have to do now is we write each of the bubbles, we write it in terms of the original element. So B1 minus beta 1 times C1 minus gamma 1, and so on. Yeah. And then what you do is you expand under the phi. Yeah. So now it's going to be 16 terms. The first one is B1, C1, B2, C2. Yeah. The other 15 are of shorter lengths. Yeah. Okay. So I say here expand. Yeah, and then proceed inductively. Yeah, so expand, and proceed inductively. So you get 16 terms with the combination of which is zero. One of them is the term that you want. The other 15 are shorter. You take each of them, which you don't know already, and you do the similar centering. And after a lot of work and a lot of cancellations, you come with this. Yeah. So I guess the moral here is that so this is free independence. As I said, it is inspired from algebra of from the framework of algebras of free groups. Yeah, it is a condition which is, so it is a recipe which allows you to do calculations. But as you can see, if you do the calculations via centering, it is complicated, and something more efficient is needed. That's the conclusion here. Yeah, okay. And now I come so to the more efficient part, yes. And so here is where the non-crossing partitions enter the game. Yeah. So let me do a quick notational review of non-crossing partitions. Yes. So as I said, so there is a handout on the website of the Winter School, yeah, which gives some basic facts about these objects. Yeah, here what I like to do is just kind of introduce a bit the notations, draw some non-crossing partitions, yes, and then for various facts that we need, we will. I don't know. Take on them as they appear. Yeah. So our the notation that I'm going to use for partitions for a partition of so it's going to be partitions of the set 1, 2, 3 up to n. Yeah. And the notation is pi. The parts which are called blocks will be denoted as v1 vk or something similar. Yeah. So these are some non-empty sets called the blocks of pi. Yeah. And partition means, yes, that they are disjoint, pairwise disjoint. And their union is 1n. Okay? And sometimes we write, so I just write V belongs to pi to mean that V is one of the blocks V1, V2, Vk. Okay. okay. Having a partition. Having a pi as above, so pi as above. What does it mean that it is non-crossing? So pi non-crossing. This means by definition that it is not possible to find distinct blocks V and W. Yeah? And numbers A smaller than B smaller than C smaller than D in 1n, such that A and C belong to one of the blocks and the B and D belong to the other. So we are forbidding a certain kind of pattern. So you are not allowed to have two distinct blocks. So V and W, they are a VI and a VJ, with I different from J. Yeah? And it's not possible to find this kind of interlacing of elements, A and C from one block, B and D from the other. Yeah? NC of N, yes, is the collection of all non-crossing partitions of 1, 2, 3. So yeah. So for instance, here is an example of a non-crossing partition of 5 elements. Yeah, and here is how we draw them. So the way we do is we put for NC of 5, yes, we make 5 dots. And then we put like kind of a fork for each of the blocks. So 1 to 5 has a fork. Here's a fork. 3 and 4 has a fork. And the partition is non-crossing means that you can draw the forks without crossings. Yeah? But on the other hand, for instance, this one, this one is not in NC of 5, because if you try to draw the corresponding forks, yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yes, you have 1, 2, 4, and 3, 5, and you see the crossing between the two blocks. Yeah? Okay? So that's the, these are the structure. So somehow it is a collection of diagrams, yes, which you draw in this way. Yeah. What's relevant is that this NC of N, we treat it as a partially ordered set. The partial order is the one by reverse refinement. So So pi less or equal rho, so where pi and rho are two partitions in NC of N, the fact that pi is less or equal rho is defined by this condition that for every block of pi, there exists a block W in rho such that V is contained in W. Yeah. So every block in pi is a part of a bigger block of rho. Yeah? Since these are partitions, you can also write this by saying, so this is an equivalent restatement that every block of rho can be broken then as a union of blocks of pi. Yeah? So the idea is that pi is smaller when it is obtained by rho by taking the blocks of rho and breaking them further. Yeah, I should mention here that we have names for the, so this partial order has the smallest element and the biggest element. Yeah, the smallest element is the one where everything is completely broken, so the partition with n singletons, we call that 0n. Yeah, and the maximal element is the partition where everything is staying together, so the partition with only one block, and yeah, these are minimal and maximal element. Yeah, so every pi is in between them, okay, and C of n, so this partially ordered set, this POSET, yes, is a very nice one. Has a lot of good properties which are advertised in the in that NC handout. Yeah. So one thing, for instance, is that it is graded. Yes. So it is a graded POSET, meaning that you can assign a rank for every pi. The rank turns out to be n minus the number of blocks. But anyway, so this gives a grading of the partition. It is a lattice. This means that every two elements, every two partitions, pi and rho, they have a biggest common lower bound. Yeah, this is like a how do you call it? GLB. Yes, it's like the analog of the greatest common divisor, and also they have the analog of the least common multiple. Yeah, and this works in connection to the partial order of the POSET there. Yeah, another interesting feature is that this structure is anti-isomorphic to itself, and moreover, we have a special anti-isomorph is called the Kreveras complementation map, which is very useful for calculation. Yeah, and all these features. So as I'm saying, like I will comment on them as they appear in the lectures. But for a discussion, so the corresponding definitions and some exercises, usually straightforward, based on those definitions, you see them in the NC handout, yeah, the second handout posted on the website. The exercise one on that second handout will be for you to count the number of non-crossing partitions in NC of N and discover that it is that Catalan number. Yeah. Okay, good. So now I introduced the non-crossing partitions. Why that? Because I'm saying these are the structures which help us sort out, straighten those calculations of free independence. Yes, which I showed. I showed you how they were going from the definitions, and they were pretty ugly from the definitions, right? So I'm saying now we're going to kind of go at them with using these structures and introducing this thing called free cumulants. Yeah. So now this is the item 4 of the lecture. Free cumulants. So let me tell you what these are. So free cumulants of a star probability space A5. Yeah. And first of all, like, what kind of object is that? What am I looking for? Yeah. So I'm saying this is a family. This is a family of multilinear functions. Kn. So Kn is on the direct product of A with itself n times. Yeah? So it's a sequence of multilinear functions. This is what we are looking for. Okay. How do we define them? Yeah? Let me show you, to begin with, let me show you the first few so that you see what we are looking at. Yeah? So for instance, K1 is supposed to be a linear function. K1 will just be phi. Yeah? So for small n, so K1 is just so you see this the structure it's the algebra A comes with a phi. Phi is the first cumulant function. Yeah, second one must be in two variables is what you call the covariance Yeah. Let me write another one. This so that you see that there is some structure, but it's not. So it's K3. This is must be something which goes in three variables. Yeah. And what you do is actually you look at various ways. So there is this product A1, A2, A3. You look at various ways of breaking it. Yeah. And you put for instance so these are all the three A's kept together. Let's break A1 away from A2, A3. Then we can break A2 away from A1, A3. We can break A3 away from A1, A2. And we can also break all the A's from each other. Yeah. And this is the formula which appears. Yeah. And you see there is some pattern, yes, namely there are partitionings of the of these three A's. Yeah. What's not clear is what's happening here, like where there are signs and coefficients which appear. Yeah. And in fact the way to go, actually, it is nicer in fact to not write the k's like define k's directly, as I was saying, but it looks nicer to write, so not k's in terms of phi's, but vice versa, phi's in terms of k's. Yeah, and why that? Because when you do that way, actually, it's going to be just straight sums. Yeah. So in fact, like the answer to what are these signs and coefficients, they appear when you first write phi's in terms of k's in the way that I'm going to do now. So phi is k1, phi of a1, a2 from here, yes? Phi of a1 and 2 is k2 of a1, a2 plus this product, which is k1, k1. Yeah, and phi of a1, a2, a3, yes, which is this one here, it is k3 of a1, a2, a3, and plus, and again, so there is all the possible breakings, yeah, here, but it's going to be without any kind of signs or coefficients. Yeah, and actually, when I arrive to write it like this, I can also start explaining what's the structure here, because here is a sum, but this is a structure sum. What I can do under each of these terms, I can now write a diagram like this. And what does it do? So the diagram follows how the A's are broken. A1 broken away from A2, A3. This is A2 broken away from A1, A3, this is 3 as a singleton, and this is 3 singletons. Yeah? And in fact, when I said that you broke in all the possible ways, actually the true statement should have been you break in all the non-crossing possible ways, but it so happens that for 3, all partitions are non-crossing. You need at least 4 points to make a crossing. Yeah? So this is the structure, and here actually it's already so clear, like what I'm going to give for the definition of the functional Kn, yeah. So this is a definition, and also has somehow a trivial bit of proposition in it, yeah. Because what I'm going to say is that the Kn's are the multilinear functions which exist and are uniquely determined by equations such as this one, yeah. Okay. So this is the definition, and with a bit of proposition in it, yes. Says let A5 be a star probability space. Yeah, question? Yeah. There exists a family of multilinear functions kn from a to the n to c, yes, sequence of such functions, uniquely determined. Such that we have the following equation. So such that for all n and all choices of a1, a2, an in A, we have this phi of a1, a2, an equals summation pi non-crossing partition of n points. What's the term? So actually I'm taking it from here. Yes. So every non-crossing partition contributes a term. Yeah. So this formula is the generalization of this. Yeah. How does the term look like indexed by a pi? So every term is a product. Yeah. There are as many factors in the product as there are blocks in pi. Yeah. Okay. So here it's a product according over the blocks of pi. Yeah. And then what is a factor? So if you also fix a block like the block 1, 3 here, what do you do? So out of A1, A2, A3, you just retain those ones which are sitting on the top of the block. Yeah. So it's phi of, and here I'm saying A1, A2, An restricted to V. Yeah. Yeah, this is a K, and actually the K must have an index, so we should put K sub V. Yeah, sorry, thank you. You saved me. Yeah. Okay. So like here, yeah. So if I take here the block 1, 3, yeah, the block has two elements, so there should be a K sub 2. Yeah, in general it is K sub the number of elements, the cardinality of V. And then what A's do we take? We take those A's which are coming from V. So indices coming from V. Yes. So the convention is that for V equals I1, I2, Im, written in increasing order, put A1, An restricted to V. This is by definition AI1 up to AIM. Yeah. So saying that you just take the A's with labels coming from V. Okay. And it's an easy proposition that this equation. So this equation, which I will call M dash FC. Yeah. This is called the moment free cumulant formula. Yeah. This is the this phi, as I was saying, we like to call them moments. These k's, we call them free cumulants. Yes, so I should say somewhere, but there's no place on the blackboard to say that. So this family of kn's, which I'm defining, these are called the free cumulants of the space A phi. Yeah, okay? So these are the moments, these are the free cumulants, and this is the basic formula which expresses moments in terms of free cumulants. Yeah? And it's easy to see that this defines indeed a unique family of kn's. And moreover, you can actually solve explicitly. Yeah, and you can write k's in terms of phi's. And I can explain what are those signs and coefficients. But I will do that tomorrow. Yeah. Right now, what I want to do is, I have a few minutes. Yes. So. Yeah. Okay. Good. Good. Perfect. So then. what I want to do is have this, and now I want to kind of come to the punchline. So give you now that concept of free independence, which I first gave as defined by Voiculescu. Yeah. Now I'll give the rephrasing in terms of free cumulants, and this will see, you will see looks much nicer, this will be what will kind of provide us with the technology to do calculations. Okay, so now last part of my talk. Yeah, so five free independence in terms of free cumulants. Yeah? Okay. So again, we take the star probability space and we take those subalgebras which we want to be free independent. Yeah. So it was A1, A2, AK. Now K is being busy with being free cumulant. So we're going to take something else. Let's take A1 up to AP, some unital star subalgebras. Okay. My goal is to state a theorem, but in order to state that theorem, it's nice to first introduce a definition. Yeah. So here's the definition. So you have a bunch of unital star subalgebras of A. I say that A1 AP have the property of vanishing mixed cumulants. Yeah. So they have vanishing mixed cumulants, and when I say cumulants, I mean free cumulants, the ones that I'm dealing with in my talk here. What do we mean by that? So it's going to be some condition. So VM FC, vanishing of mixed free cumulants. And you go like this. So again, you start. It's somehow analogous to the definition of free independence in the original way. But it's going to be, you're going to see much, much simplified. So you take some indices, I1, IN, indices between 1 to 3 up to P. Yeah. There is no requirement to have consecutive indices to be different from each other. They can vary. Yeah. The one thing that you don't want to allow is that they are all equal to each other. So these are some indices which are not all equal to each other. Okay. And then having these indices, you pick some elements A1 in AI1, AP in AIP, yeah? You don't make any restriction on the A's. You don't ask that they are centered. Just any elements from these corresponding algebra. So you see, all the requirement that I do is that not all the A's are picked from the same subalgebra. Yeah? So all the I's being equal to each other would mean that just I've picked all the A's from the same place. So you don't pick them from the same place. Then the corresponding cumulant is zero. Yeah? Because actually this is what you would call a mixed cumulant. Yeah? Mixed cumulant means that you mix somehow elements from different subalgebras. Yeah? Vanishing mixed cumulants means that this must happen. Okay?
It's A-I-N, right? In the bottom.
A-I-N, absolutely, yeah, sure. A-N, yes. A-N. So it's elements A1, A2, A-N. So A1 in A-I1, dot, 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 up to A-N in A-I-N. Yes, and I1, I2, I-N, they run in this collection from 1 to P. Okay? Okay, and now here comes, so this is a theorem which was proved by Speicher in the 90s. Which says that the subalgebras, so A1, A2, AP, unital star subalgebras in that A phi, they are freely independent. If and only if they satisfy this VMFC condition. Okay, so then.
One direction is obvious.
Sorry?
One direction is obvious.
One direction is easy, and the other direction requires some work, but it's not a very hard theorem, but it is a very significant theorem. Because this is now the handle on free independence, which allows us to really treat it by using enumerative combinatorics, specifically the combinatorics of non-crossing partitions. Yeah? And what I want to do from here, yes, is kind of show you so how these cumulants can be calculated, yeah, and how you can do various kind of like it's a little technology that is being developed. Yeah, do I have time? So. Yeah, okay. So let me advertise that this first handout, the warm-up handout, so it's having that introductory part which I covered today, but after that it's having a last part which has some exercises, which are kind of like elementary statements, which you could in principle do directly from the definition of free independence. But also you might in principle do them from the definition of free independence, but I think that would be kind of stuffy, yeah, and those exercises we will actually do them in the next lecture, and you will see that they become kind of quasi trivial once you learn how to operate with free cumulants, yeah. And let me take 5 minutes or 2 minutes or I don't know, like to actually kind of revise the first two exercises from that part. So these will be the exercises 7 and 8 from the handout. And actually, this is also throwing a bit of terminology. So in free probability, well, free probability is in the end some form of probability. So you like to actually deal with densities and distributions and be able to calculate. Yeah. And the way you go in the framework of star probability space, you kind of tend to name your elements after the density that they follow. Yeah. So for instance, definition. So you've got your star probability space A phi, yeah, and you have a self-adjoint element there, yeah, and say that I'm also picking a radius R, yeah, okay. We say that A is a semicircular element of radius R. So it's like this is a condition on moments. So we ask that the moments of A in this abstract framework of A phi follow the semicircular density of radius R. So to mean that, for every n, phi of a to the n is equal. So what do I have to put? So here I must put for normalization half of the area of a circle of radius r. Okay, integral from minus r to r, t to the n, square root r squared minus t squared dt. Yeah. So what's this? This is the density, yes, which is going from minus R to R and is following a semicircle, yes? And you take this quantity is called the moment of order n of the density. You know that the sequence of moments of A follows the sequence of moments of the density. If this happens, then you call the element by the name of the density, yeah? Okay? But as it happens, these are integrals that are easy to calculate, and you get zero if n is odd. And if n is even, what do you get? Well, you get the Catalan number. Yeah? So you get r over 2 to the power n, Catalan number, if n is even. Yeah? Okay? So so these are, and like that we have, say, so if the sequence of moments, instead of being this, if you just have the sequence of moments 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, which are like what you get when you flip a coin, you call that a Bernoulli element. And you have like lots of densities like this, which have elements named after them. Yeah? But here is a nice little exercise. I believe this is exercise 8 in my handout. So it says like this. Suppose that you have two elements which are semicircular of two radii. Say A is semicircular of radius R1 and B is semicircular of radius R2. And now we have to put some free independence. We want that A is free from B. But what should that mean? So we define the free independence for algebras. Well, we say that the algebra generated by A is free from the algebra generated by B. Yeah. So such that A is freely independent from B. And this means that the algebra actually the algebra generated by A, this is the span of powers of A. Well, so algebras, star algebras generated by A and B are so. This is what. So free independence for elements means that you can place them in some algebras which are freely independent. Okay? But the point is, okay, take these guys and add them together. Yeah? Prove that this is another semicircular element of radius R, which is square root of the sum of squares. So prove that A plus B. So what I'm doing here is the addition of two free elements, which are semicircular, yes, is a semicircular element of radius R equals square root R1 squared plus R2 squared. So if you just take this with the definition, what do we have to do? Well, you have to look at the moments phi of A plus B to the n. Yeah? So need phi of A plus B to the n. The case of odd n is easy. So phi of A plus B to the n, you can kind of easily see that that is going to be 0. Yes, these are even distributions. But okay, so if you take A plus B to an even power, yeah, what you need to prove, yes, is that this gives, for this r, it is r half to the power 2n times the Catalan number cn. Yeah? This is what you need. Yeah? And how would you do it? Well, what you can do is you take this A plus B to the power 2n and you expand it as a sum of 2 to the power 2n terms, and every term will be a word in A's and B's. And then you have to use must use those rules of free independence to calculate those terms, yeah, and you get various values. And those values, you must prove that they add up to this Catalan number. The normalization by R half is easily dealt with, goes away, but still there is a combinatorial statement of some substance, yeah, to show that when you do that expansion and you do all the calculations, in the end, you get a Catalan number. I suspect it can be done directly. So from the definition of free independence, boom, go to this. But as you will see tomorrow, once you go to free cumulence, this is a trivial statement. Like you're going to laugh at it when you see what was the proof. Yeah. Okay. So the laugh remains for tomorrow, though.